We all know how the journey through the digestive system ends, but few give much thought to how it begins. If the mouth is the doorway, saliva is the greeter. One of the most important substances produced by the body, yet one of the most overlooked. And to many, one of the grossest, conjuring up words like... What did I say? I can't... M-O-I-S-T. I can't say... Alright, fine then. Let's move on, Moist. Perhaps the best way to really appreciate saliva is to learn what it'd be like to live without it. I give you the time-honored scientific tradition of the Salting Challenge. Six crackers, no water, 1 minute on the clock.
I can't swallow. There's nothing in my mouth.
To make saliva, cells pump out salts, and because of osmosis, that draws out water. Unlike with tears or sweat, that salt is then taken back up by the glands, leaving you with something that's about 99% water. The other 1% is proteins and other molecules, which give saliva that sticky feel you know and, well, have feelings about. But that 1% is also where most of the cool spit happens. But not all saliva is secreted equal. We pump out two different brands of mouth juice. Unstimulated saliva is secreted by hundreds of tiny glands all over our mouth, and we make it essentially all the time. This saliva contains a special ingredient called mucin, which is a protein that loves to soak up water, creating a kind of gel that forms a thin protective coating all over your mouth parts. Mucin is basically why saliva sounds like this. On the other gland, stimulated saliva is, well, what it sounds like. It flows when we smell something delicious or chew. Really doesn't matter what you chew, could be anything, but I suggest food. Or maybe gum. We have special sensors beneath our teeth, and when they feel the pressure of mastication, they send a signal to crank up the spit factories. The super sour or salty foods also stimulate saliva, basically to dilute the acids or salts and protect your mouth. You can test this. Just put a drop of lemon juice on your tongue and wait for the floodgates to open. Lots of people think sugar causes tooth decay, but it's really caused by acids released by bacteria who eat the sugar. Saliva dilutes that nasty stuff so you can keep your teeth. And since we make less saliva when we're asleep, that's prime time for tooth decay. But you always brush before bed, right? You probably know there's two salivary glands under your tongue, but most saliva that comes from chomping and tasting is made by the parotid gland, situated between your ear and mouth. It's not here or here so much, but right here. Now, obviously, this type of saliva makes eating possible by lubricating your food, but it also contains a bunch of proteins. Now, the exact saliva protein mix varies throughout the day, but the most abundant is amylase. Amylase is an enzyme. It chops long, complex sugars like starch into simple ones, because glucose is what cells crave. Try this. Hold a bite of cracker in your mouth without swallowing and let your saliva go to work. After a few minutes, a sweet taste begins to take over as the starch in the cracker is broken down into simple sugar. Sweet. Proteins are one of the reasons babies drool so much. Baby saliva contains enzymes that help digest milk, so when milk's your only food, you make a lot of drool. In fact, enzymes from saliva that break down starch, protein, and fat are manufactured on large scales and added to laundry and dishwashing detergents to help them literally digest stains. In most cultures, spitting on someone is just about the grossest, worst thing you can do, yet we don't mind swapping spit with the people we love. At least, that was true before you watched this video. Now, I don't expect that we'll all stop being a little weirded out by saliva anytime soon, but if you take a second to chew on the idea, when it comes to multi-purpose liquids, saliva even puts sriracha to shame. You know what? Drool rules. Stay curious. mouths only serve as angers, so they can curl around a sharp stinger and inject a dose of venom, a painful reminder that they're in the same order of insects as bees and wasps, the Hymenoptera. Insect researcher Justin O. Schmidt developed a pain index for Hymenoptera venom, mostly by allowing himself to be stung over and over. The tiny sweat bee, for instance, is a 1, a tiny spark singeing a single hair. The bullet ant scores a 4, the most painful grade, like firewalking over flaming charcoal with a 3-inch rusty nail in your heel.
Fire ants only score a 1.2 on the Schmidt pain index, but they tend to sting multiple times, like this one did. It's already starting a local immune response around that venom. It's red, it's itchy, it's burning.